Started out. So where do you play? Like, what's like a regular gig for you?
A regular gig for me has got to, since this is how I pay my bills, and I also raise two children. We have a house, we have pets, we have two cars. My wife doesn't make a ton of money either, and neither do I. Unless you look at it by the hour. I can make really great money by the hour. But a typical gig for me would be within 50 miles of here. I live in Oshawa. Be within 50 miles, I'd probably play for 3 or 4 hours. And I'd probably come home with $100. So that would be probably an average gig. And if I do 5 of those a week, it's a good year, and I've really done that just about for 30 years. I've just about averaged 5 gigs a week. There's some interesting things that happen, though. To try to get paid several hundred dollars, I have to go out of town, because in town, when you play 5 nights a week, that means anybody can hear you like 230 nights out of the year. They have 230 chances to hear you. So they don't put much value on you. Somebody from out of town comes, they sell tickets, this might be your only one chance to hear somebody. Which brings up something else about the accolades. I'm not saying I'm a great musician. I'm just saying that in terms of to play music and to be loved for what you do, it also helps to be from out of town. You know, when you're local, I see people come in from out of town and they're playing and the place is packed and they've sold tickets, you know, $15 a ticket. And I might be sitting out there going, wow, I'm pretty sure I'm as good at playing as that guy or that woman. I think I can sing just about that good. How come nobody pays $15 a ticket to hear me in town? When I play out of town, I'm up there getting that love, and I look out and I see me sitting there going, that guy's not very good. Why are we all here paying $15 a ticket? So it's an interesting life, playing music.
So when you go out of town, where do you go? Where are some?
I've been around North America, and I've also been to South America. I've been to China. I've been to Bulgaria, Israel, Western Europe, all over Canada. Oh, Australia. Been to Australia too. But it takes a long time. I didn't go overseas until I was in my 40s. I've been playing professionally since I was 21. My first gig was a professional gig was Timberline Lodge, I think, when I was 20. I had done some other jobs, but I played at Timberline Lodge for 2 years, about every other Saturday. What else? Yeah.
How much would you say that you practice? Practice a lot.
I can tell you that these days, I don't practice a ton, but I had to practice a ton to get good enough to get into the business. So this is what happened to me. I was not real strongly, well, I'm not gonna say I wasn't motivated, I'm gonna say I had almost no work ethic when I was a teenager. And, you know, I got very average grades in school, but I was good at playing the piano, but I didn't work hard at that either. And I got a talent grant offer from a community college. So I had to move 200 miles away, but my school was going to be paid for. And I was going to play with some really good college-age musicians and professors. So when I got to this school, it's Mount Hood Community College, I got there about a week early, And I went to the music department, which was always open in those days. The security is so different today. It was open 24 hours a day if I wanted to play the piano. At night it would be locked, but the security guards would let me in. I'd turn on a light, I could stay all night. I started hearing some of the other players, you know, through the practice room walls. And man, I heard piano players that were so much better than me, and it just scared me so bad. I went, what am I doing here? I'm gonna be a complete failure. I'm gonna make a fool of myself. At that point, I knew what a major scale was, and I knew that between C to C, that this spelled out a major scale, but I didn't even know how to do that in the other 12 keys, because I had just been playing some Beatles songs and some simple rock and pop stuff. And I knew I was going to be taking music theory class and all this stuff, and I couldn't even read music. I couldn't read notation. So I was terrified, and I started to practice. And then I got myself a teacher. And eventually, I didn't have the strength because I had never worked hard at the piano before. I started doing exercises to build up stamina, muscle stamina. About a year later, I was practicing 5 hours a day. It was like a job. And fear not being good enough was driving that. So I had my motivation. Fear is a great motivator. Desperation, I usually call it. So there were several years where I practiced that much. And then I just started working 5 nights a week, and I didn't need to practice to keep my, to stay limber. So my practice stopped being piano exercise type things, and it just meant learning songs. That's what I do now. I don't practice exercises. I learn, try to learn new material. Is there any other comments or?
Yeah. Well, what was your favorite country to format?
My favorite what?
Country to format.
Did you say country?
Yeah, like when you've gone out of the United States.
Oh.
Any
country
favorite?
Country to perform at.
Yeah.
I can tell you Bulgaria was amazing. Because they, you know, they were no longer behind the Iron Curtain, as they called it. It was still a socialist country. They were coming out of socialism, and country's very poor, but they wanted to hire Nancy King and me to come play at this jazz festival, which is a whole new idea to them too. And it was at a town up in the Balkans, up in the mountains, where they wanted to turn it into a ski resort and attract wealthy people from around the world. I don't think Bulgaria had ever had a ski resort before, let alone a jazz festival. So they had to pay us a couple $1,000s a piece to go there, but we were only going to perform once. So that's probably the most money I ever made for an hour and a half's work. But it took a week to do it. But the reason I loved it so much is we were so tired when we got there and just wanted to sleep. But they came and woke us up. We'd been asleep for a half an hour. We arrived in the evening. We were going to perform the next day or the day after. They woke us up and said, we have a surprise for you. We go, we don't want a surprise. We just want to sleep. We've been awake for 24 hours. They go, no, you can't miss this. They took us to the festival, and one of the most unique choirs in the world. They're also very obscure, but they used to be called the Bulgarian Women's Radio Chorus, or State Bulgarian Women's Radio Chorus. They call themselves the Mystery Singers now. They sing this amazing stuff, and they have a cult following around the world. I knew who they were, but I didn't know that they were going to sing to us, and they sang an English song. They sang, oh, Susanna, won't you cry for me, in English, but it was in like 5/4, 7/8 or something time signature. It was crazy. And they did that for us. That was such an honor. And then later on in the tavern, a couple of nights later, they were all in there. And to be honest with you, they were, it was like a convention of truck drivers. They're all women. But man, they got tattoos on their arms, chain smoking cigarettes, calling for drinks, and singing in the tavern, you know, just for fun. It was incredible.
Yeah.